Good morning, everybody. Welcome to church as we turn our eyes to Jesus. For us, we're doing that live in real time. Some of you, I'm going to invite you to do that as you start to watch the DVD or as you're watching on YouTube. If you're watching, catching up with us, just take a moment and turn your eyes to Jesus before we start into the rest of the service. It's a wonderful invitation for us. Let's pray first thing, and then we're going to go straight into just, I think, a favorite hymn of many of us. O Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder. Father, we've come together this morning to worship you, to adore you, to turn our eyes towards you, to turn our eyes to Jesus, to turn our eyes to the hillside, the cross as we share communion, to turn our eyes to heaven as we look and proclaim his death until he comes again. Come to take our eyes from the things which have been occupying and demanding our time and our attention and our energy. We come to focus on you. We don't leave those things aside, Father. The other things, if they're on our hearts and they burden us, then we want to bring them to you in this time. But we would lay them at your feet and cast our burdens upon you, knowing that you care for us. Would you help us to do that? And would you speak to us, and would you glorify yourself, and would you bless us this morning as we join in some wonderful songs, as you speak to us through your word, as we come to the climax and share communion, remembering Jesus, his death and his resurrection and his coming again. Speak to us in all of these things and glorify yourself, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
My God, how great thou art.
song. Hope you enjoyed that. Right. Why are we talking about rechargeable things this morning? Well, because, you know, with our rechargeable things, headphones, or I've got my speaker here that I use, or this baby speaker, and I'm impressed that none of you gave me one of these mobile phone, because you knew that was going to be so obvious, didn't you? They all have to be recharged. When they're used for a long time, their batteries run out and you have to redo them. Do you know what? We're a bit like that. We're not batteries, are we? But as people, as boys and girls and grown-ups, sometimes it's like we run out of puff. We run out of energy. Now, I know children, you never do that, because I remember when my children were young and I would say, I think you're tired. Oh, no, I'm not, Dad. They were never tired. But I'm sure children in Fressingfield and era, you're not like that at all. If your mum and dad says, I think you're tired, you need to go to bed, I'm sure you all say, yes, Dad. Yes, Mum, I am really tired. Please, can I go to bed now? We run out of puff sometimes and we need rest. And we need to sleep, and that recharges our batteries. Do you know what? Jesus also had times when his batteries ran down. There was one time when he had a really busy day, lots of days actually, probably a really busy week for him, and he'd been all over the place. He'd had to walk a long way because they didn't have cars or buses or taxis or bikes even in those days. Jesus had gone to different places, and everywhere he went, people came and asked him to help them. It was also a time when he was really sad. His best friend, one of his best friends, had been killed. So he was feeling sad, but everywhere he went, people went to him and said, oh, Jesus, please, can you help our friends? So every time Jesus would go to get some rest, people would go to him and say, please help us. So instead of getting some rest, he would help them. He helped his mother-in-law who was sick. That's not his mother-in-law. It was Peter's mother-in-law. Peter was one of Jesus' best friends. His wife's mum wasn't well, and Jesus made her better. And then people got to hear about him, and the whole village where he was were bringing all the people that weren't very well. And they said, Jesus, please, will you help them? And he did, and he made them all better, all of them. I think it's fantastic that Jesus has got the power to do that. It's why we can pray for people when they're not very well. And Jesus can make them better. But at the end of the day, it tells us that Jesus eventually had to go away and get some quiet. And you know what he did? It wasn't that he wanted to go to sleep. He wanted to go away and to talk to his Father in heaven, to talk to God. He wanted to pray. And, you know, sometimes not only do we get physically tired, but we need to make sure that our spiritual batteries keep getting full. So children, this is what I want you to remember this morning, grown-ups as well, that's where doing what we're doing now is so good for us. When we either we go to church or we come to church like this at the moment, and where we sing our songs and we're with people who are all the same, it helps us and it kind of gets us going again. When we pray and when we listen to God speak, when you go to Sunday school, when you go to Ixtus, when you go to Friday Club, when at home, and I hope you do this at home, you read a Bible story sometimes and you talk with mum and dad or your grown-ups about, you know, Jesus, and maybe they pray with you before you go to bed, and I hope they do as well. You know, that kind of thing, it all helps. So when we forget Jesus, then we end up and we'll get grumpy and we'll not do the things we should. Our batteries are run down spiritually. So church and Sunday school and Ixtus and Friday Zoom, brilliant. Sunday's really important as we come together and we enjoy the songs and we can pray. So boys and girls, grown-ups, that's the talk this morning. Just want to encourage us to make sure that we keep our batteries topped up regularly. Each day if we can. If we can't, then at least regularly. And if worse comes to the worst, just on a Sunday. He's better than nothing, but that's what this is all about. So children, hope you remember that, and well done on the remote control, on the charges, the charges this morning, the things that needed to be recharged. I think you did exceptionally well on that. And grown-ups, those of you who got some things as well, brilliant. Right, we're going to have a song, and It's the song that the Von Debs did for us at Holiday Club, and it was their quiet song. It's the thank you song. And we're going to listen to this, and I hope you'll join in. There aren't actions to it apart from just going like this. When I look at Jess and Courtney, they're just swaying. But it's a song that, and this is what recharges our batteries. It's saying thank you to Jesus. Thank you for all that he is, and thanks for all that he's done. So let's enjoy this song. It's different for us this morning, but it's a lovely song. Let's let our batteries be recharged as we say thank you to Jesus.
Jesus, the gift from above, for taking my
Right, we're going to we'll pray later on. Neil is going to lead us in our prayers, and he'll pick up some of those things, I'm sure. That's going to be part of our communion service, or part of communion that we're going to end up with this morning. Very much part of the whole service. If you love Jesus, then just make sure that you've got your bread and you've got some wine or suitable, and I'll leave that to you. They need to be meaningful for you, but we'll remember Jesus. And our message this morning will kind of lead us into that and bring us to an aspect of that that sometimes we can overlook. So we're going to come to look at our Bibles now. I'm going to hand over to Ray, first of all. He's going to do our scripture reading. It's in 1 Corinthians, so you need to be finding this, everybody. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses, he should be reading from verse 12 through to 27. So 1 Corinthians, that's New Testament, chapter 12, verses 12 to 27. And you'll see the relevance of this as we continue our series looking at the church. And this morning we're going to be thinking about the church as the body. So Ray, over to you. Thank you.
The human body has many parts, but the many parts make up one whole body. So it is with the body of Christ. Some of us are Jews, some are Gentiles, some are slaves, some are free. But we have all been baptized into one body by one spirit, and we share the same spirit. Yes, the body has many different parts, not just one part. If the foot says, I'm not part of the body because I'm not a hand, that does not make it any less part of the body. And if the ear says, I'm not part of the body because I'm not an eye, would that make it any less part of the body? If the whole body were an eye, how would you hear? Or if your whole body was an ear, how would you smell anything? But our bodies have many parts, and God has put each part just where he wants it. How strange a body would it be if it had only one part? Yes, there are many parts, but only one body. The eye can never say to the hand, I don't need you. The head can't say to the feet, I don't need you. In fact, some parts of the body that seem weakest and at least important are actually the most necessary. And the parts we've got regard as less honourable are those we clothe with the greatest care. So we carefully protect these parts that should not be seen. While the more honourable parts do not require this special care, so God has put the body together such that the extra honour and care are given to those parts that have less dignity. This makes for harmony among the members, so that all the members care for each other. If one part suffers, all the parts suffer with it. And if one part is honoured, all the parts are glad. All of you together are Christ's body, and each of you is part of it. May the Lord bless these words.
Indeed, thank you, Ray. Right, so let's dig into this and see what it's got to say to us. We are looking at the series, sermons on Sunday mornings, looking at the church and what it is, what we're about, and what our purpose is, how we should act this morning. It's the fifth one in the series, and we're going to be thinking about the church as a body. We're going to launch off from this passage here in 1 Corinthians. We're going to slide over to a passage in John's Gospel, John chapter 17. We're going to have a look in there, and then we're going to come back and conclude back in Corinthians again. So we're thinking about the church as a body this morning. And the big theme in each of this part of our series is about the unity of the church. We're looking at the pictures. Last week we looked at the church as a building. This week we're looking at the church as a body. In a few weeks' time, 2 weeks' time, next week, it's, guys, in case you've forgotten, here's a little tip for you. It's Valentine's Day next week, 14th, all right? So don't forget, you've got no excuse now. So we're going to look at the church as a bride next week, and then we'll have a look at the church as an army. The thing with each of those is about the unity and the wholeness of them. And that's what we find particularly in this analogy here in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. You'll find the same kind of thing in Romans chapter 12 as well. Let me give you, so here we are. Remember this picture, the body of Christ. You'll see the body there and all little cogs, all making up, and they would all need to be working together. Just keep that picture in your mind. We'll come back to it. Wanted to, another picture here for you, a little map. With the city of Corinth, so you can get a location of where Corinth is. Corinth was in southern Greece. Here's the map coming up. There we go. It's the red dot in the middle of the screen. I hope that you can identify that as the southernmost part of Greece. Now, its location is actually really important. All right, so that's slipped a little bit. The little dot needs to go up just a tad. Martin, you might just want to leave that on there for a moment, because I think it's quite helpful for us. Because of its location, Corinth itself as a city was really diverse. It was a really cosmopolitan place. If you look at the, I don't know, I can't show it. Martin, you've got that's it, that little strip of land, that area there where he is. And if you can go to the isthmus itself, Martin, go down southwest, just there, what's there, you can see a little strip of land. And what used to happen was boats that wanted to go from one side of Greece to another, instead of going all the way around the bottom on the Peloponnese peninsula bit, they would go into the Gulf of Corinth. They would be manually pulled up and drawn by hand over land across the little strip of land and out into what I think would be the Aegean Sea. It saved them weeks of travel. So it's a very popular route. Corinth grew up serving that trade because it was a place where merchants went. It was a place where obviously the sailors would go through. It was a center of industry and trade. It was a hugely cosmopolitan place. It was a major trade route. People would go from east to west and west to east, and they would go through Corinth. So with that diverse group of people, they brought their religions. So Corinth was a very religious city, serving the people that traveled through. It was also at the same time a very irreligious and immoral city. Sailors have a reputation. They're away for months on a time. I'm not going to just use your imagination. So there was a lot of immorality. There was a huge amount of diversity. There was wealthy people. There were poor people. There were traders and there were slaves, all finding their home in this place or passing through. Now, the wonderful thing was that God began a work in that city, and he started to save people. He called them out from all over the different places, all over their backgrounds, regardless of who they were. God called out and created and set up, established a church in the city of Corinth. That church was made up of the same kind of people. People who were business people, people who were slaves, people who were rich, people who were poor, people from different cultures, different backgrounds, different religions, and they came together, saved by grace, came into the church, which is wonderful, this diversity. And yet that very diversity caused them problems. Sadly, as Paul wrote to them, this letter and 2 Corinthians that we're looking at in our small groups, in the life groups, he wrote to them because at this particular time, the church had become, just a few years after it had been founded, had become a bit of a spiritual basket case, to be honest. It was racked with division across just about every line that you could have imagined. There was moral division, there was religious division, there was social division. It was all there in this church. And so Paul wrote this letter to deal with those issues one by one. And it's important that we read the letter in that context, that we know what he's doing. He wasn't simply writing a theological treatise of theology. He was writing to a very specific church with very specific needs, and that was what drove the content of what he's doing. He was writing a pastoral letter to try and prevent the church shattering into a thousand pieces. So you got this church, very diverse, very divided. What did he do? How did he write? Did he write and say, look, you need to set some rules here. You need to make sure that you all are the same. You need to listen to your leaders. And you need to stop being so different. You need to start being and acting all the same way. Well, he didn't do that at all. Very easy to kind of lay the law down, isn't it? And say, right, you're going to do it my way. So everybody becomes the same. But he didn't do that. What Paul did was said, look, you are all different. God has made you different. You've got to accept your differences of character, your differences of background, your differences of gifting and abilities, your differences of social standing. But here's the thing, guys, Paul said to the church. He said, you've got to remember, whilst you are different and you can accept that, you are one. He said, you are the body. A body is one, although it's got lots of different components. Just as he said, one body, though one, has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. It's 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 13. For we were all baptized, he said, by one spirit, as to form one body. Whether Jews or Gentiles, slaves or free, we were all given one spirit to drink. He says, you are one. No matter whether you look differently, behave differently, come from things and have different perspectives, you are one. So in one sense, the unity of the church isn't something that we simply strive for. It's something that we work from. We are one, says Paul to the church there. It wasn't, unity wasn't something to create. It was something to maintain. His answer to division, his answer to the differences was to show that rather than subdue them, the diversity was a blessing from Jesus. And they should celebrate it. They should welcome it as a good thing, as a helpful thing, as something that made them stronger and better than if they were all the same. It's as if Paul was saying to them, look, your differences, guys, your differences, your diversity is what makes you so strong. It's what enables you to be what God wants you to be. Your diversity is what enables you to serve as you do in the church. The fact is, no one is more important. No one's more valuable. No one's more significant. Every part is crucial. We go back to that picture of the body again, Martin. If you can just pop that back up again. I've cropped it down this time so that it comes up, hopefully, and it makes it even clearer. We see the body here, this image here, all those little cogs, some bigger, some smaller, right down to the end of the fingers, all little cogs. But you know how a clock works. They're all connected. They're all dependent on each other. And that, says Paul, is how it is in the church. You see, God doesn't want us to be like this. If we go to the next picture, God doesn't want us to be like a bunch of sausages. All the same, all neatly packaged, all manufactured to be the same. God made us different. He made us, as we thought last week, living stones, not bricks that all go neatly stacked on top of each other, but living stones, different shapes and sizes that need to be worked and fitted in together so that one works here and another works there, you know, to work together. You've seen a dry stone wall. If you've ever tried to make something with stones, you take them and you look at them and you turn them around and then you put them in places. You can see where that's what we're like. We're all different. We're not the same. And Paul doesn't say we should be the same. God in his word here doesn't say we should be the same. We're all different. The different backgrounds, cultures, personalities, characteristics, character traits, family backgrounds, strong points, weak points, and gifting from God. He says that is what makes you so strong. He's made us different, but we're to be, and we are, as the church, we are the body. And this whole subject of unity, unity among God's people, unity among the church and the local church, is a crucial one in the New Testament. And I wanted just to take a little look at this by going back to look at Jesus. Did you know that in the New Testament, the unity of the church is spoken about in one way or another more times than heaven? It's spoken about more times than hell. And when Jesus was about to be arrested and put on trial and go to the cross, we get in John chapter 14, John chapter 13 through to 17, we get a little glimpse into those last hours of Jesus spending time with his disciples. And John has recorded the theme of what Jesus spoke about. Now, I don't know about you, but I find that people's last words are often quite significant. And we look here at the last words of Jesus before he went to the cross. And the theme of Jesus' teaching and the theme of Jesus' prayer to his Father in John chapter 17 was, well, there were two things. One was how much God loves you. And the second was then make sure that you love each other as well. The first one, God loves us. The second one is that we must love each other as well. A couple of examples of this. You could turn to the passage if you like. In chapter 15 of John's Gospel, Jesus said, my command is this, that you love one another as I have loved you. You see, there's those dual things. I've loved you. You must love one another. Greater man has no one than this. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down his life for his friends. And that's what Jesus was about to do, wasn't it? He says, I want you to be the same. I want you to do the same. He said, this is my command. Love one another. I've loved you. Now you've got to love each other. That is what the big theme of Jesus' teaching was. There was other things, but this loving each other, being united, was a crucial one in there. Then right after these instructions, we got Jesus going out and a record of him praying to his Father. And it's interesting what Jesus prays. There was 101 things that he could have prayed about, wasn't there? But you know, having set out in chapter 17, verses 1 to 8, he kind of does a ministry resume of what he's done and sort of talking to his Father. And he says, look, it's done, Father. I'm about to come to you. So, Father, I'm going to pray for the disciples here and now, the ones that I'm leaving behind, these 12, these 11, these ones that are going to carry straight on. I'm going to pray, Lord. And this is what I pray. And he prayed. You find this in verse 11 of John chapter 17. He prayed, Father, will you protect them? Will you keep them so that, keep them, Father, so that they would be one like you and I are one. Father, protect them, keep them, Lord. Father, keep them, otherwise they will fragment. Keep them, transform them so they stay as one. He then prays for those who've not yet become Christians. So he's praying for you and he's praying for me in verses 20 to 24. What does he pray? We find pretty much the same thing. Verse 21, he says, Father, I pray that for them that they may be one. Verse 22, I pray that they may be one. Verse 23, I pray that they may be brought to unity. Wow. Jesus prays over and over again. This is so important for him, the unity of his church. We see two things here. Number one, he says, Father, they may be one as we are one. The model for our unity is none less than the Trinity of God. So the Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Different persons, but one God. Each having different roles to play, each one being willing to serve each other, but working in perfect unity. He says, that's how I want the church to be. Yes, they're different. They have different abilities, different gifts, but Lord, help them to be together, indivisible, undivided, as we are. And you know, at a practical level, if we pause and apply this just for a moment, this is one of the reasons why church unity in a local church and in the whole church is so important. It's one reason why we should grieve when any church starts to fragment, when we see the church fragmented. I mean, one of the great criticisms of the church in our nation, Western Europe and in the world, from non-Christians, one of the great criticisms is it's so divided. Jesus does not want it to be divided. He wants us to be one. Now, how that works out, well, that's a different thing. But we should be striving to model and to mirror what God's character is. The second aspect of this is not only is our do we model God himself, but what we see in these words from Jesus is that unity is a major component of our mission. In verses 21 and 23, there's a little phrase, so that they may, the world might believe, so that the mission might go on. Make them one, Lord. In Jesus' mind, our togetherness, our unity as a family, if we want to put it like that, as a body, is crucial to our task of ministry. It is critical evidence to the message that we believe and that we preach. If we can't be united, if God's church can't be united, then what does it say about the power of God? Now, we've seen Jesus' thing of unity, the importance of it to him. I want to go back now and do this very quickly because we've got communion, and this is going to lead us into communion. Go back to the passage in 1 Corinthians where Paul pictures the church as the body. In, as I said before at the beginning, in this letter, Paul is responding to issues that have been raised, issues that have created tension in the church in Corinth. He's dealt with things like food, what food to eat. You see, some people felt very comfortable with eating food that had been sacrificed in pagan temples. It didn't bother them at all. Other people said, you can't possibly eat that food. That's awful. It would be sacrilegious. Paul had to sort that one out. He had to deal with differences of people's preference to their leaders. Some were saying, oh, I like Paul. Oh, no, he's not as good as Apollos. But Apollos loves us much more than he does. And he had to sort that one out for them. Differences of personal preferences. He had to talk about relationships. Said that Corinth was a very immoral city that had been brought into the church. People, as they'd come to faith, didn't realize, didn't understand, hadn't heard the Christian ethic of marriage and the sanctity of marriage and one man, one woman. And there was all kinds of things going on in the church. And Paul has to write to them and say, guys, there's a right and a wrong way to do this. He has to talk to them about relationships. He has to talk to them about how to settle their differences. When you can imagine, can't you, when people get, you know, they come against each other, they're going to fall out. And people, Christians, were taking each other to court, the secular courts. And Paul had to say, look, guys, you can't ask the secular courts to be sorting out your spiritual issues. And so he talked to them about that as well. He talked to them towards the end of the letter about the resurrection of Jesus. Some people were thinking it had already happened. Now, let me rephrase that. Jesus had been raised. They all understood that. But what they didn't get was the fact that those who followed Jesus were going to be raised to life. Or if they believed they were going to be raised to life, they didn't know when it was going to happen. And that some people thought that it had already happened. And others said, no, it was still to come. You know, we might think, well, what a strange thing to argue about. But remember, for them in their culture, that was a biggie. They were coming with all sorts of presuppositions. So Paul has to write at length about the second coming and the resurrection of the body. There was one other thing that he had to sort them out on. And that was, strangely enough, the thing that should have bound them together more than anything else. It was the Lord's Supper. It was communion. The picture here, he had to talk to them about how to remember the Lord. And so he comes to the passage which we often read. I pass on to you what I pass on to you what the Lord passed on to me. And following this talk, we're going to move straight into our time of communion. a time where we'll be remembering our Lord Jesus, a time when we'll be feeding our souls on him. But tragically, for the church in Corinth, this had become a major, major point of division for them. You see, let me explain the situation. I've got another picture here for you. So we've got pictures rather than words today. Picture here of some people, some friends sharing their food together. The New Testament pattern for communion was actually quite different to ours. If the Corinthians came or any Christian came to our communion service, the way that we would traditionally do it in our churches, they wouldn't recognize it as communion as it was started off. They would have a fellowship meal. The church would get together. They would be eating an ordinary meal. And as part of that, they would pause and they would break some bread and they would pray and they would remember Jesus. As part of it, they would take some wine and they would pass it around and they say, remember Jesus at this part of our meal. And that was how they would do it. They would pray for one another. But what was happening in Corinth was that the church was coming together and the rich were down one end and the poor were down the other. And as they'd all brought their food, most of it was provided by the rich and it stayed up the rich end. So some were getting loads and they were gorging themselves basically. And it wasn't getting passed down to the poor people. So some were getting fat and some were being left empty. The wine likewise was kept up the top end of the table so that some were drinking it all and getting drunk and others weren't getting anything to drink. And Paul said, you've got to be kidding. You can't even call this communion. You can't call this the agape meal. This is not the Lord's Supper, what you're doing. And he said some really serious things to him. He said, look, the way you're doing it, do you know what? Because you are not recognized, this is meant to be something that you do as the body of Christ. And you're not remembering, you're not thinking. Some of you are not recognizing the rest of the body. You're not thinking of your brothers and sisters. Christ's body is one and you should not be hogging all the bread and all the wine. You should be sharing it so that everybody can remember it. This is not the communion. This isn't the Lord's Supper. And he said, because you're doing it like this, that you're desecrating what is precious to God. He said, he uses these words. He said, you're despising the church. You're humiliating others. Wow, strong words, but he says stronger. He says, and because of this, some of you are sick. And some of you have gone asleep. And he didn't mean falling asleep because the preacher had gone on too long. Some of them had died. Why? Because they'd been abusing the Lord's Supper. So you've got to remember each other. So when we read the words about not recognizing the body, it's not about not thinking spiritually about Jesus. It's not recognizing the church as a whole. It's not thinking of each other. It's being selfish. It's just thinking of me. You see, the church, the communion is meant to be a together thing. It's not meant to be an individual thing. It's meant to be a thing that people do and they look around and they think of each other. And that means the way we're doing communion at the moment on Zoom, it is what I would call sub-optimum. It's less than ideal because we can't be with each other in one place, looking and thinking of each other. But it's the best we can do. I want to encourage us this morning, when we take communion, to put yourselves onto gallery view. This is the practical thing of this. We've talked about unity. We've talked about oneness. And this final bit here where Paul goes back to Corinth and he talks to them about the Lord's Supper. He said it's not an individual thing. It's a together thing. Now, we're in our own homes. Some of us are by ourselves. Some of us are in couples. Some of us are in families. But this is a church thing. It's not about us individually. It's not about you. It's not about me doing communion to the Lord. This is about us together. And it's hard to do that when we're on Zoom, isn't it? And it's why some people have said, you know, whilst we can't gather, we're not going to do communion. Because really, it's not as God meant it to be unless we can be together. I respect that. I don't feel it's that strong, but which is why I encourage us to share communion on Zoom. What I want us to do this morning is rather than have a speaker view on, when we're doing communion, put yourself onto to gallery view so that you can see as many people as possible. If you've got a tablet, you probably only get 12 screens. Well, as you take the bread and you take the wine, flick through the screens and look at your brothers and sisters. Look at the rest of the body. I want to encourage you to pray for them. There might be someone that you haven't spoken to for ages, might be somebody that you don't particularly get along with for all I know. I don't know. But pray for those people. Think of them. Let's recognize this morning. Let's do as best we can to recognize the body of Christ. Now, of course, if we're going to do that, we need to be part of the body, don't we? So what we find in the New Testament is that those who took communion were part of the body. They had to be Christians. It was Christians, those who were genuine followers of Jesus, those who'd come by faith to Jesus, repented of their sins, said sorry and trusted Jesus and pledged themselves to follow. Those were the ones that took communion. Those were part of the body. The others might have been well-meaning, and they might have been there, and they might have been observing, but the actual act of bread and wine, it was something for the Christians. It was something for those who were part of the body. If you're part of the body this morning, if you've come by faith to Jesus, if you've trusted him and you're seeking to follow him, then please, as we come to share after our song in a moment, look around, be grateful for the family, be grateful for the body. Thank God for the different people, those who are very different to you. I want to encourage you this morning. Say thank you to God for them. Let's recognize the body of Christ. And as we continue, as we, you know, whilst we're on Zoom, it's tough. And I'm missing being with you more and more. I tell you, every week I find it harder and harder. I long to be with you. I miss just being able to shake your hands or give you a hug or just look you in the eye or sit down on a seat next and just to be talking to each other. I miss that so much. I say that with no embarrassment at all. I long for us to get together. I hope you do as well. You see, we are one, and I think this is better than some of the other ways that we could do church. But it's not the best, is it? Let's do the best we can. Let's treasure our unity. Let's treasure the fact that we're part of one body. Let's appreciate each other's differences. We'll have another look at this at some time soon, I think, because I think this is just such an important thing, that we're all significant, we're all important, and how we can play those roles and what God does and the gifting and the way he works it all together. I don't know when we'll do it, but we will do. How do we, you know, practically, how do we maintain it? What are the things to look out for? We'll have another look at that. But this morning, we are one. We're one body. And as we share and remember the Lord together now, let's do the best that we can to recognize the body of Christ here in Fressingfield, the body of which we are a part. We're going to have a song before we do. We're going to have the song. We're going to listen and I hope join in the song. It's called Behold the Lamb. It's a Getty song. I've chosen it because there's a repeated refrain. It talks about around the table of the King, and it talks about to make us one. It speaks of what Jesus has done in order to make us one body. So let's use this song, transition ourselves in, get your bread, get your wine, get your cups ready, and we'll have a simple communion service. We'll recognize the body of Christ. And then within that context, also Neela's going to lead us in our prayers today. So let's have the song, please, Martin.
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us. And we remember the promise made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. And so we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of peace around the table of the King. Body of our Savior Jesus Christ, torn for you. that healed the death that brings us life, paid the price to make us one. Every stain of sin shed for you. Drink and remember, he drank death's cup that all may enter in to receive the life of God. So we share in this bread of life.
Favorite song for many of you to finish with. There is a higher throne. Jesus is coming back, but he's on the throne at the moment, and we're going to be with him. So let's enjoy this song. Let's worship him together.
There is a higher throne than all this world has known, where faithful ones from every tongue day come. Before the sun we stand, made faultless through the Lamb. Believing hearts find promised grace, salvation.
to him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence with great joy and without fault. To the only God, our Saviour, be glory and majesty and power and authority from this point and until he comes again. Amen. Amen. And God bless you. Thank you. Thank you for joining us this morning. I hope that the service has been a blessing to you, wherever you are, whatever life is like for you at the moment.